What's up, world? And welcome to the All Real Show. This is where we discuss issues pertaining to the socioeconomic system and how they relate to everything. Why and how are the fundamental questions? Answer them enough, you get to the truth. I'm your host, Alex, and welcome back to part two of my discussion with John Spritzler. So, John, we talked at the end of last episode about you getting over 1,000 signatures of people declaring they wanted egalitarian values and principles implemented, along with the BACC proposal pertaining to gentrification in your neighborhood. That didn't go as you planned, but you didn't give up. So tell me what you did when you found out the BACC wasn't really for the people.
Okay, well, so what I decided to do was I had to acknowledge to myself, see, I was naive. I thought I could change the BACC.
Mm-hmm.
So that was a mistake on my part. I was naive. I didn't realize what I was up against.
Yeah, you just didn't know until you tried, you know.
Live and learn, okay?
Right.
So then I decided I need to, fill the same fundamental goal. I need to do something that would let the public know that it was the majority and wanting the egalitarian revolution. So I thought about what I could do. The problem with collecting the signatures was that I didn't ask people for permission to make their signature public. It didn't occur to me because I thought the fact that I was getting the majority of the members would get the organization to declare that it was for egalitarian revolution, and that would be the way that people would see that lots of people wanted it. They saw a large organization saying that that's what its goal was. But okay, that didn't work, and since I didn't have permission from the people who signed to make their signature public, I couldn't just take pictures of those signatures and display them and everything. So I changed my tactic. I decided that I was going to ask people to pose for a photo,
mm-hmm,
to be shown publicly, where they would hold a sign saying they were for egalitarian revolution. And so I proceeded. I made up the sign. I actually made it in different languages. They're always saying the same thing. And this is what the sign said, that I asked people to hold in front of them and pose for a photo that I would take. And I told them this would be to go online, to be seen publicly.
Mm-hmm.
And so the photo says, the sign says, "We the people want affordable housing for all, period. To get it, we aim to remove the rich from power, to have real, not fake democracy with no rich and no poor." And then the sign said that this photo was taken in zip code 02135, because I wanted it to be clear that I was getting lots of people, but I didn't have to go all over the country to get lots of people. They're all right in my own little zip code.
Right.
And I got more than 500 photos of people holding this sign up, which are online. The PDRBoston.org website has a number of different links that take you there. And, I'm hoping that because it's easy to look at the photos and to see, there are more than 500 people holding these signs. And also, by looking at the photos, you can see that these people are ordinary people. They're just people.
Right.
Almost all of them are people who are on their way into either the grocery store where I shop or the CVS drugstore where I go. And they were just on their way into these stores. And, they're old and young. They're men and women. They're, black and white, Hispanic, and some Muslims with scarves. And, there's some middle-class type people and working, mostly working-class type people. And, the idea that you can get with a glance is that, wow, we're the majority.
Right, right. Yeah, I saw that, John. Again, that was extremely inspirational. I was going to ask you about that because I didn't know if that was kind of in conjunction with the back thing or if it was different. I thought it was different. So that right there tells you in a short amount of time, you not only collected 1,021 signatures, essentially declaring that same statement, and then on top of that, you had over 500. So in your little area alone, in a short amount of time, you've had 1,500 people come out and say that this is what they ultimately want. It's very inspirational. I saw the pictures. And that, to me, John, you know, I think I commented when I saw it, something to the effect that, you know, that's what needs to be done and that's what needs to be said and that's what needs to be shown. You know, I mean, look how simple, you know, in one way it was so simple, but in the other way it was so impactful. And, you know, people feel a lot of times, well, what can I do? There's nothing I can do. You know, I just, something like that. All you did was go out there and do that and take these pictures. But by seeing it, and I saw you displayed the banner of all the pictures in front of the grocery store. Then I think you took in the library.
Yeah.
And of course, posted it online. Just that act alone, John, you know, all those people that were involved are now more aware. All those people who saw it and will continue to see it online are now more aware that they aren't the minority. You know, they are the majority.
Yeah, it's true. And by the way, everyone listening to this interview, I say to you, you can do this too, and I hope you will. All you need, you know, is a little smartphone, print the sign, just to take it to your local, you know, UPS store or Staples or whatever and get it laminated, say cheap, and then stand in front of a supermarket or a drugstore or any place like that where there's a fair amount of pedestrian traffic.
Mm-hmm.
And ask people to pose for a photo, and you find that, this is what you find. You find a lot of people, you know, won't stop to see why you're there because they're busy. Well, that's just normal human behavior.
Yeah, of course.
I mean, I myself probably wouldn't stop if someone was standing in front of the drugstore when I was entering it for some unknown reason that I didn't particularly feel like stopping to find out about. You know?
Right.
But the ones that do stop, almost all of them thought it was a great idea, you know, and held the sign up. And so this is easy to do. It takes time. I mean, you know, I'm retired, so I have time in my hands. So, okay, you know, if you have to work, you know, maybe you can't do it as much or whatever, but you can still do it weekends or whatever. This is revolutionary egalitarian activity. Now I know it's a little harder with the stay-at-home order now, but that's not going to last forever. And what I did is, as you mentioned, I made a banner with more than 500 of these photos on the banner, and I display it in public. And it's wonderful for people to see at a glance how many people, you know, agreed with this egalitarian revolutionary message.
Yeah, it really is. It's great, and it's inspirational.
And I had fun. There's a lot of times what happened with the banner, because I displayed the banner in the same place where I took a whole lot of the photos, people would stop and they knew that I had taken the photo, and so they would look to try to find
the picture
on the banner. And it's sort of like a Where's Waldo thing, and they would be so happy if they find, you know, it usually take them about 10 minutes to sort of find the photo, and then they would find it, and a few times people who found their photo would stop other passersby and tell them, look, here I am, you know, and this is good. You should support this. It's a good cause, you know.
Yeah, well, you saying, John, about, you know, you're retired. Obviously, you have time. It's time consuming. But I say it all the time that if you care enough, basically, you have to care enough. But everybody can do something. Everybody can do something. And anybody who does something will have an impact in one way or another. And, you know, you can't underestimate the reach or the impact you may have. You know, I mean, hypothetically, even if you, you know, reach five people, you don't know who they're going to talk to about it, you know?
Yeah.
And so you can't underestimate that. That's a defeating way of thinking, you know, to say, well, what can I do? Or it's not going to have an impact. Or, well, I work all, you know, I work too. And, you know, I take all pretty much, too much really, but most of my free time to try to do this show and reach out to people and things, because for now, this is what I'm doing to try to make an impact. And, you know, you have to stand for something or you'll fall for anything. And I do think it's important, though, to stand for the right thing, of course.
Yeah, here's a point I need to emphasize, which is that there's a strategy behind this tactic.
Mm-hmm.
And it's important to understand the strategy, which, as I discussed briefly earlier, the strategy is based on, first of all, an understanding of the reality that we're in,
mm-hmm.
which is that most people would love an egalitarian revolution, but they think it is impossible.
Right.
Because they think hardly anybody else wants it, so who would make it, join a movement large enough to make it happen. Okay. Most people do not understand that that is the reality. Most people think the reality is the contrary. They think that most people are against the egalitarian revolution. This is the reason, by the way, that most of the people voted for Biden in the primary recently. Those people, I can guarantee you, for the most part, would have preferred Bernie Sanders to Biden to be president.
They just felt like he wouldn't win, right?
Right. But they voted for Biden because they thought that nobody else preferred Sanders to Biden, at least not enough people, that most people would prefer Biden to Sanders,
mm-hmm.
and that in order to defeat Trump, therefore they needed to vote to make Biden the nominee. You see? So the wrong belief about other people, which the ruling class works very hard to make people have that wrong belief, is widely held, and it's the reason for the hopelessness that prevails.
Right.
So egalitarian revolutionary, the first step is to reject the wrong idea about what reality is and to understand what's the correct idea. Now, how do I know what's the correct idea? Because the things that I've been doing on the street.
Yeah, you see people's response.
And I say to people listening to me right now, if you think I'm wrong about the overwhelming support for egalitarian revolution, then ask me to send you a PDR button that says let's remove the rich from power, but real not fake democracy with no rich and no poor, or just write that on a 3x5 card and ask random people that you meet, maybe just in the course of your ordinary, life at work and shopping and so forth, or standing somewhere on a busy street corner, whatever. Ask random people if they think that's a good idea or a bad idea, and you will find out that on the order of 90% of the people you ask will say it's a good idea or a great idea. When I went to a pro-Trump rally, 86% of the people at the pro-Trump rally, random people, said it was a good idea. And when I offered them the button, those 86% of the people who said it was a good idea, all of them took the button, and many of them printed on themselves right on the spot. This was a conservative, mm-hmm. pro-Trump rally, okay? So anybody who tells me, I'm wrong about what I'm saying about the general public, I'm saying, no, you find out for yourself. Don't find out by reading the newspaper or listening to the radio to find out what the ruling class wants you to think.
Yeah, exactly.
Find out what the truth is by actually talking to ordinary people. And don't find out the truth by saying, well, are you for socialism or not? That's crazy. Good people who want an egalitarian revolution, many of them are against socialism, including me.
Yeah.
Including me. So, don't be like a Marxist and think that the litmus test for being good or bad is whether you support some Marxist, idea of having the Communist Party be the new dictatorship or the Socialist Party, like in France under Hollande, which was as anti-working class a government as any, but it was all socialist. Don't think that people who are against socialism are not therefore for God's own revolution. That's a big mistake. The left has great contempt for ordinary people. It thinks they're bad. It thinks that it would be terrible if ordinary people were in control because they're racist and homophobic and selfish and greedy and complicit in crimes with U.S. foreign policy, and this goes on and on and on. But the left thinks that the idea of having a movement based on the values that are widely shared by most people would be terrible.
Well, when you start talking left and right and conservative, to me, those are all separations. I know they kind of supposedly define a stance or, you know, a thought process, but to me, they're all separation, because if you're left, you can't be right. If you're right, you can't be left. You know, I think the one common thing, like you were saying, is if you use the word egalitarian, that's, I mean, that does define it, but that's what people want, you know, ultimately.
Yeah, but the thing is, when I ask people on the street, I don't use the word egalitarian because nobody knows what that means.
Right.
I say, do you think the message on my button or the sign or whatever is a good idea or a bad idea? And I use the word to remove the rich from power. A real, not fake democracy, no rich and no poor. Those are words that have a clear meaning to people. And stated that way, you will find that about 90% of the people think it's a great idea. And so I'm getting back to the strategy, why I was taking photos of people holding the sign, why it's important strategically, which is that because most people do want an egalitarian revolution, even though I've never heard the word before, the key strategy at this time needs to be to use tactics that help people discover the fact that they're in the vast majority in having this egalitarian revolution aspiration.
Yes, I agree.
That will create a situation where people will change from being hopeless to being hopeful and gain the confidence that it requires, and it does require this confidence, to do things like create organizations that have egalitarian revolution as their goal. So in order to let people see that they're a majority, we have to come up with tactics that help people do things to demonstrate that a majority of the people feel this way. Now, this is challenging because the fact that people are so hopeless means that they don't think it's sensible to devote much time or energy,
right? That's true.
Doing anything along these lines. So what I have had to do was think of ways that people could help demonstrate that it's a majority wanting egalitarian revolution. Ways that I call baby step ways. Ways that require minimal devotion of time and energy, and that's what they're taking pictures of people. Came from. You see, I'm not asking anyone to join an organization and read emails or go to meetings. No, I ask people to stop for maybe 5 seconds to hold a sign while I click the shutter, and that's it.
Yeah.
And then to continue shopping. And as long as the amount of effort I was asking was very, very minimal, many people would do it in spite of feeling hopeless about being able to accomplish the goal of, you know, the Palestinian revolution. Same thing with collecting signatures. It was a short statement, didn't take long to read, and all they had to do was sign it. And by the way, the main question that people asked after they read the statement was, where do I sign?
Yeah.
So as long as the tactic is one that does not require hopeless people can devote a lot of time and energy to something that they think is hopeless about accomplishing, you can get a lot of people to do it. And when you get a lot of people to do it, eventually people start seeing that they're not the hopelessly weak kind of minority, and then that will lead, I think, to more people thinking that it makes sense to devote maybe a little bit more time and energy than they otherwise would have thought. This I learned this in 1969. When I just graduated from Dartmouth College, and I was getting on as an outside agitator for Students for Democratic Society in the anti-Vietnam War movement. And I wrote an article about this, but the long and short of it is that after many years of being a tiny minority and just standing with a little peace sign and organizing what turned out to have been a very successful anti-war Vietnam teach-in, we in this very small anti-war, 12 of us or so, we thought we were a tiny minority. But the conservatives then called to a pro-war demonstration, and we dreaded the day that that demonstration was to occur. But to our total surprise, while there were 50 people who showed up with pro-war signs, out of a campus of only 3,000 students, 1,500 people showed up with anti-war signs.
Wow.
So for the first time, we knew we were in the majority. And only because of that, and of course knowing that it was morally right to be against the war, but only because of knowing that also that we were in the majority, for the very first time, we thought about something we would never have dreamed of doing until then,
mm-hmm.
which was taking over the administration building, demanding that it abolish the Reserve Officer Training Corps, ROTC, that trained second lieutenants for the war,
mm-hmm.
which we did. And it led to a general strike when they used cops to pull people out of the building, and faculty voted to abolish ROTC, and the trustees had to fly in for an emergency meeting because there was a general strike to shut the school down, and the trustees voted to abolish ROTC.
That's awesome.
They did.
Yeah.
Now, what made that happen was that we discovered suddenly, on one very particular day, we discovered we were the majority, and everything changed
right.
as a result of that. And I have been trying to make people see that they're the majority when regarding the egalitarian revolution.
Yeah, it inspired and energized you guys, and that's what it would do to anybody. And when you're, you know, you feel that camaraderie, and you don't feel so isolated and alone, and you realize that there's other people wanting and fighting and, you know, the same thing. And I get the point you're making, and that's why I made the statement earlier that I think, in my opinion, that is probably one, if not the, but one of the definite top three things that really is the most important to be happening right now, if you can, is to spread awareness and enlightenment and, you know, let people know that they're not alone in thinking or wanting these things, because you're bombarded by, you know, basically every single media outlet, whether it be news, radio, or, you know, they're spewing the same thing, the divide and conquer. And, you know, and it's, yeah, it just makes people feel ultimately like other people don't want that. And that's why I think it is so good, John, what you do. And, you know, just to kind of stress again what you had said, the point you were making a minute ago, that such a small effort, basically, you did. I mean, yes, it took time. You had to do the sign, whatnot. But seemingly such a small effort, you know, it didn't require organizing thousands of people and marching on the streets. And granted, that's great. But, you know, there's all kinds of things that somebody can do, especially if you use your imagination and creativity that most people suppress and really, really need to get back in touch with, is their imagination and creativity, because you're limitless in what you can do. You're only limited by your own imagination. And you prove that with something like that, because, again, seemingly such a small effort, and ultimately it was compared to most things. But the impact, I think, was huge for one person, just, you know, retired, going out there doing that. The impacts you had, you know, at minimum, you affected those 1,500 plus people that signed that. I mean, that's a guarantee, because, you know, they signed it, they're aware, you know, all that, they read it. But obviously, you just that one act alone, or two smaller acts, you impacted so many other people. And I think that's huge. And that definitely deserves a round of applause, because it is, John, that's very, very important. And, you know, speaking of that, of more and more people understanding, I wanted to kind of just quickly go into sort of where we left off on the first show. And that's kind of where we stopped was, okay, so say you talk to people and they understand, yes, this is, you know, wrong, corrupt, unfair, unjust. What's the next step to you? What would you? Because you know, I do this. I talk to people. And people have different ideas. A lot of them think, you know, build like, you know, these eco villages or do this and that and just start trading thing, you know, on a small scale. And I mean, what's your thoughts on that? What would be the next step if people say, okay, you're right. Now what? What would be, you know, your vision of what would cause some true change?
The next step after the strategic goal of letting the majority of people know that they are the majority, and after that?
Yeah, I mean, basically, because when I was saying at the end of last show was about that I thought you needed like a blueprint, basically, to give people. So the ones who do say, you're right, I agree, you know, where do I sign, let's do this. The ones you don't have to essentially convince or whatever, you know, I was saying that I think you need like a blueprint, and, you know, but you still have difficulties because what are you going to do? You know, even if you want to kind of go, you know, do your own thing and start a community, a egalitarian community, for example, you still have to get resources and trade with, you know, the outside world and stuff. So, and you were just saying that you had ideas about stuff like that. So I was just curious what your thoughts in general would be.
Okay. Yes. The problem in answering a question like that is that what makes sense depends on what the situation is at the moment that you're talking about.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, if you're talking about what it makes sense to do, right now, well, let me put it this way: what it makes sense to do just before the pandemic,
right?
Pandemic sort of creates new practical obstacles, obviously. But what it made sense to do just before this current pandemic was, you know, obviously I thought about it and I came to the conclusion that what made sense was to take these photos of people for the reasons that I've just been articulating.
Right.
To help the public see that they're the majority feeling this way. Now, just before the pandemic, we started doing something. After collecting the photos, I and whoever I met in the street who wanted to help, at least a few people, we started, I ordered stickers to be made, and the stickers said on them the following: luxury housing, : built by and for Steve, Hiedes, , to drive working class folks out, ! And with pdfboston.org underneath.
So you think ultimately the awareness is really what needs to happen, right?
Well, yeah, I made a bunch of those stickers, thousands of those stickers, and I and people that were helping that I met on the street were sticking them up in public places on lampposts and whatever to be seen publicly. The idea was to let the public in my neighborhood see that they were not alone in not just being angry at all the luxury housing going up, but in viewing the people who were building them and the rich people who were living in them as thieves.
Right.
The thing about calling them thieves is that, you know, what that basically implies is that they're doing something morally wrong and shouldn't be allowed to do it, which is very different from the reformist kind of way that the BACC leaders put it, which is they said, oh, there's nothing wrong with building luxury housing. It's just that they should have 20% affordable housing units instead of 13%. You see what I'm saying?
Yes.
And then just days before the pandemic made me decide to stay at home, I'm 73 years old, and I'm trying not to die from COVID-19.
Yes, right.
Just days, you know, a handful of days before the pandemic kicked in, I had been in conversations with people I met on the street about calling a demonstration of us and whoever else we could persuade to join us, where we would stand in front of one of the luxury housing developments that was being built in the neighborhood with signs that would be like, you know, like the sticker calling them thieves, you know, condemning them that way, and also with other egalitarian themes. And we were about to call a demonstration, which, you know, we knew it wouldn't be a huge demonstration, you know, because we're just starting, but it would be one of the first that was actually a demonstration against these luxury housing projects, as opposed to writing letters, you know, to the mayor, with the organizations doing. And we'll also be doing it in an egalitarian revolutionary framework. And it would, you know, we were hoping and thinking it would, you know, get more people inspired to want to join us, maybe, despite their hopelessness. And that's one of the things that we were planning, which, you know, is now on hold. But, you know, it'll probably happen before too long. So these are answers to your question that are based on the assumption that the situation is the current situation. But I could give answers to your question about, you know, what's the next step, that would be based on the assumption that things are the way I hope they would be in the future, where there's a very large egalitarian revolutionary movement, for example, with, you know, substantial, you know, organizations with substantially large size explicitly advocating egalitarian revolution, then, you know, there are, I think, things that could be done, which would include also, you know, large demonstrations and maybe much more militant demonstrations against bad things that are happening, you know, with the theme being not just that we're against the bad things, but we have a vision of how society ought to be. And there could be ways of spreading that vision so that people would have what's lacking now, which is an explicit vision of how things ought to be, which is what builds confidence. You know, part of what's necessary to build strong movement is that people need to know that what they're for is morally just. And part of something being morally just is that it has to be practical. You know, I mean, people could say, well, I think that we should have only sunny, beautiful weather forever, right? And if that's not possible, then, you know, you're not going to build a movement for that, even if people wanted it, you know. But people have to know that the vision is practical,
right,
that it makes sense, that it can work, and that it would make things indeed better, unlike communism, which is so ugly. And people know it's ugly. It's dictatorial. People need to know that egalitarianism is true democracy, with the vast majority really calling the shots and so forth. Well, in order to know that, there has to be a lot of discussion about, well, what would it be like? How would it work? How would it do X? How would it do Y? How would it respond to this question and that question? You know, I try to do a lot of that with the PDF off the website. But what's needed is for a mass movement that does it with a huge public conversation, with, you know, meetings and letters to the editor and, you know, all sorts of, you know, teachings and, you know, whatever, you know, sky's the limit, to have a huge public conversation about not just what we don't like about the status quo, but what we're for.
Right.
Because to a certain extent, you know, it's true that people don't get on the bus if they don't know where it's going.
Well, the narrative is, I mean, I agree with that. And obviously it's the narrative that's pushed on purpose, but, you know, people idolize a lot of times, look up to, envy, whatever, people with a lot of money. And the reality is, if you're very rich and you essentially don't apologize for it, you know, you're wrong. Because you should understand that it's not right that I have so much money and all these other people are literally starving to death with no home, no anything. So, yeah, I mean, the narrative is the big thing, you know, and I agree that it's got to be, that's the way things have to be looked at. And ultimately, I agree, John, that that's the awareness, I think, is almost number one, because without it, you know, you can't do it. I mean, being the people and not the power, you have to have a lot of people on the same page and calling for the same thing, because it doesn't matter how right you are, how eloquent you are when you say it, or aggressive you are when you say it, it doesn't matter. It's, you know, you can't do it on your own or even with a small group of people. So I agree that ultimately that's what it is.
Yeah. One thing that I think would be a good thing to do when there's a large enough movement to really do it is for people to perform local assemblies of egalitarians, which, as my webpage discusses, these are assemblies where all the egalitarians in the local community have a right to participate in as equals with all others. And in an egalitarian society, these local assemblies would be the sovereign power. They would be the only governmental body that could pass laws that everybody in the community had to obey. Well, until there's an egalitarian revolution, until the rich have been forced, have been removed from power, as I discussed earlier, you know, losing a military force that would obey their orders, until that happens, these local assemblies of egalitarians would not have sovereign power, obviously.
Right.
But they could still be like a shadow government, which is what they call it in England. The party out of power acts sort of as if it were in power, and, you know, makes statements about what it would do if it were in power. Well, the egalitarian revolutionary movement can have shadow assemblies of egalitarians that would, you know, make public statements about what laws they would pass if they had the power to enforce them. And so people could see exactly, you know, or at least much more clearly, what an egalitarian revolution would make possible when it can finally remove the rich from power. And that would make it, you know, so that people could see much more concretely and much more inspiringly, you could see the vision of the goal. And this is all the way that you build the strength and determination of the movement, which, as I said earlier, is what's required to persuade the members, a critical mass of the members of the military, that if they go over to the side of the movement, refuse orders to attack it, they'll be going over to the winning side and not be shot as a traitor. But we need to do these kinds of things in order to remove the rich from power and to win. But at this particular time, I tried. I actually tried forming egalitarian local assembly of egalitarians, and the hopelessness was too thick.
Right.
So that people didn't show up to the meeting. You know, I've engaged in a lot of trial and error. I've learned things, and hopelessness. You have to deal with the fact of the hopelessness. You can't wish it away.
Right.
Or pretend it wasn't there. You have to deal with it. You have to do things that are designed to change the hopelessness into hopefulness. And that's what I've been working hard to figure out how to do.
Yeah, and you've, as we've pointed out, the two things are the signatures and the picture. I mean, as far as what you just said specifically, I think the pictures of the people had the biggest impact as far as that. You know, to see that, to vision. I mean, a signature's nice, and it was right for what you were going for, you know, to take it to another organization kind of thing, and, you know, get a different proposal. That's obviously pretty much the way you go about it. But for inspiration, awareness, you know, like you said, turn hopelessness into hopefulness. The picture thing, I think, was perfect. I mean, when I saw that you had done it, that's, like I said, that's why I commented something along the lines of, you know, that's what needs to be done. That's what needs to be said and shown. I think it had a very big impact.
Well, anyone who's listening to this interview who wants to do something along those lines, they should contact me. My website has the email address you can send to. It goes to me. And I will do everything I can to help you to do it. That's what we need.
That, because you have two of them, obviously. Which one is your contact info on? Both of them, I guess? Or
yeah, both of them give it. The PDR, Boston.org. By the way, in case people can't hear it clearly, the PDR is P as in people.
Right, People's Democratic Revolution.
Democratic Art Revolution, PDR, Boston, BOSTON.org. If you go there, at the very bottom of every page, it has peopleforDemocraticRevolution@gmail.com as an email address.
Okay.
If you send anything there, it'll go to my personal email, gets forwarded, and then we can proceed to communicate back and forth with, you know, my personal email to your personal email. And I would be happy to send people some stickers, or I've got two kinds of stickers, the kind that have the same thing as the PDR Boston and the one about luxury housing. It's a little hard for me to send buttons because I have to go to the mail, like the post office, and until I am no longer staying at home, that's not in the cards right now. But
yeah, that's a little tricky with some of that now. But both the websites and the Facebook group, all the links will be in the description to the show. So
Yeah. So, if people want help, advice, or for me to send them these stickers and stuff, they should just get in touch. Some other people have done it in some other parts of the country, and we need for it to happen more.
Yeah. Both of them, the newdemocracyworld.org has all kinds, it's the type of website with the links down both sides and then some stuff down the middle. And there's a lot of stuff on there that's, it's really interesting read, and it's not just, you know, you talking. It's factual basis, and there's a lot of variety on there. But the PDRBoston.org is really lays it out. Like you said, you answer a ton of, you know, kind of what if or type questions. You explain, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, what egalitarianism is and what it, you know, define it. Compared to other isms, and essentially, in a nutshell, it's true democracy is basically what it boils down to. I mean, as far as the decision making and stuff, and then the other stuff, the resources and the fruits of the labor, it explains that too. But it's, to me, it's just how things should be. You know, that's why I say that a lot. You can put different labels on things. And like you said, I know that too. A lot of times it'll throw people off, or it'll confuse them, or it'll turn them off. And yeah, you have to call it something, you know? So egalitarian by definition is what we're talking about. It is the definition of true democracy. But that's really what it is when you boil it down.
The word egalitarianism, ending with the ISM,
mm-hmm.
is, to my knowledge, I haven't seen that word elsewhere. The word egalitarian is used as an adjective, is used, you know, fairly frequently in some places. But the idea of there being something called egalitarianism, to my knowledge, is not discussed elsewhere. I chose to use the word egalitarianism because it was not being used elsewhere,
mm-hmm.
so it was pretty much free for me to define it the way I wanted to define it,
right.
which is what I've done.
Mm-hmm.
And also, the word egalitarian has very, very little, if any, negative historical baggage attached to it, in contrast to socialism and communism, which both have a lot of well-deserved negative baggage attached to them, and so that's why I've been using the word egalitarian and egalitarianism.
I see.
By the way, before it occurred to me to use the word egalitarian, I was using the phrase democratic revolution to mean what I now call egalitarian revolution, and that is the reason why the website is called People for Democratic Revolution instead of People for Egalitarian Revolution, because it hadn't occurred to me to use the word egalitarian when I created the website.
I see. Yeah. Yeah. And that's like I was saying, man, it is a little tricky. I mean, you have to label stuff something, you know, it's like I say, you know, words are for description, not definition, but
right.
A lot of times to a lot of people, different words are definitions, even though they shouldn't be. And so, you know, that's why I was kind of stressing a second ago and egalitarian, or, you know, people's like, what's that? That's some utopian. That's this or that. That's, I don't even know. You know, it instantly turns them off. And I'm not saying that it does, but it could, or different words might, but you have to call it something. And yeah, if you just search, you know, the definition of egalitarian, it's pretty common. I mean, basic, you know, fairness and equality and, you know, no class inequality.
Yeah.
And, you know.
Yeah, that's why I picked the word. That's good connotation. Can I just say, I'm never going to end the question, but if people click on the word socialism or communism on the homepage of tdiboston.org, it'll take you to articles I've written that explain why I am an anti-communist and why I am an anti-socialist, although socialism doesn't have any well-defined meaning, so you have to read the articles to see what I'm talking about.
Okay, yeah.
The short reason is that Marxism is, and you can read about this in detail, Marxism is fundamentally anti-democratic. It's not just that, you know, some Marxist leaders are anti-democratic, you know, because they stray away from the Marxist ideal. No, if they're true Marxists, they must be fundamentally anti-democratic. And this notion of that people connect Karl Marx to the idea of reach according to ability, reach according to need, the fact of the matter is that Marx used that phrase in an article called The Critique of the Gothic Program, in which he explicitly says that society, until the far, far, far distant future and final phase of communism, that society cannot be based on that principle. His point in using the phrase was that society could not be based on that principle.
Mm,
you know, a lot of people don't understand this. You know, Marx did not create that phrase from each according to ability, each according to need. That was created by someone who wrote about it before Karl Marx was even born. And not only that, the idea of sharing according to ability and need and so forth is what the disciples did that talked about in Acts, A-C-T-S, in the Bible.
I know a lot of people refer to Marx and Marxism, and I don't know. The way I feel about it is, and I know a lot of, philosopher, intellects, whatever, people like you and you know, that are very much into, you know, the social constructs and stuff, they at least are knowledgeable of these different aspects, like socialism, communism, you know, Marxism, whatever you want to call it. I just feel like, I mean, you can pick and choose. Maybe the guy said good things, maybe he said bad things, but whatever he said was a long time ago. I mean, so I feel like we, you know, that's the thing that's, I don't know, it's not really a pet peeve, but something I don't like and I don't agree with is when people constantly revert back to, you know, what this person said or what they meant. Well, they were in a totally different time. They didn't have the technology we have now. You know, they didn't have the knowledge of how to hydroponically grow food, or maybe they did, but definitely not to the extent that we have it now. They didn't have aquaponics. They didn't have a renewable energy. You know, they didn't have an internet infrastructure. They didn't have satellites. They didn't. So it's, I don't know. To me, it's almost obsolete. It's, I mean, it's fun if you're just discussing it, like, you know, hey, let's talk about this, you know, and analyze it. But to relate it or take anything as though, I mean, it's outdated. It's way outdated.
Well, I you know, it's true that Marx lived, you know, and wrote around 1848 and those decades, and everything he said is true about how things are different now versus then. But Marxism is a philosophy. It's a very coherent philosophy. That's one of the main reasons that it has so many adherents. And it's a philosophy about society and how societies change from one form to another, and the relationship between people and technology and so forth. And it's wrong, is the point. Mm-hmm. The main thing about it is not that it's outdated, it's that it's wrong. But Marxism, a lot of people will find this very hard to believe, but it's true. The Chinese Communist Party is truly following Marxism. It teaches all the levels of education for educating the public. Not just the universities, but in the high schools and maybe earlier, I don't know about it, you know, elementary school, I'm not sure, but in the post-elementary high school level and the universities, Marxism is a big part of the education of Chinese people. And I mean Marxism, you know, Marxist reading, Marxist philosophy, Marxist dialectic, the whole shebang.
Wow.
Seriously. It is relevant to making decisions by the government today in China. And as I said, it's wrong, and I disagree with it. But it's not just some outdated philosophy that no one takes seriously anymore. The Chinese Communist Party takes it very seriously.
Oh, yeah, no, I wasn't insinuating that at all. In fact, the opposite. I understand how seriously people take it. You know, I didn't realize it was that ingrained in the China or Chinese, wherever that, you know, that the government uses it as a doctrine almost. But
well, here's something that people should know that might change their attitude towards Marxism. One of the things that I went through in my article about Marxism is another article I wrote that was titled something like the Wonderful Ideas That Existed Long Before Karl Marx, you know, things like solidarity and the fact that working people have conflict of interest with the upper class and you know, the need to share the wealth, you know, in an egalitarian way and so forth. A lot of people think that these ideas were invented by Karl Marx, which is just not true. He didn't invent them at all. They were around long before Karl Marx. But this is what Karl Marx invented. He invented the idea that was behind what he wrote in a letter to an American newspaper around 1850. In this letter, he starts out by talking about British imperial rule in India, and he starts out by describing how brutal it is to the Indian people, and he concludes by arguing that in spite of its brutality, it is necessary for the Indian people to advance to a better society. It is necessary. You see the point?
Well,
Marxism.
Yeah, that's Marxism crazy.
Marxism argues that capitalism plays a progressive role in human civilization by developing the means of production and so forth. And that for a period of time, depending on the circumstances, it is absolutely necessary for there to be capitalism. And the Chinese Communist Party obviously agrees.
Yeah. Yeah. I know some of Marx. I mean, don't get me wrong. I'm not totally ignorant to stuff that he said. But ultimately, I think history is good and you can learn from mistakes and trial and error and, you know, where we've come from and those things. The way I ultimately feel is I feel like if you started right now, anybody, you know, just pretend almost like if you could look at a different world, say we discovered, we just discovered Earth and these people are on it. And somebody said, what would be the fairest, most efficient system? I mean, yes, you have individual wants, you know, needs, desires, those things. You know, that's where you deal with it in a societal, democratic way. But as far as the way society should be structured and laid out, to me, it's elementary. This is what I understand why it's not implemented, of course, because the powers that be don't want it. And from individuals sort of analyzing it, though, I don't know. To each his own, I guess. John, I apologize. I know we've gone way over here. I really sincerely appreciate you taking your time again to be on the show, back for the first time. Everything you've done, it's really great. You know, everybody has a choice, and you know, you're making a choice to do everything you can in your power to, you know, do the right thing and spread equality. And it's just always, it's nice. It's a pleasure talking with you. And I thank you for taking the time to be on the show.
Well, Alex, it was a pleasure being interviewed by you. You're an excellent interviewer. I greatly appreciate that you wanted to interview me about this. And I thank you very much.
Okay. Yeah, you're welcome, John. Take care. Best of luck with you with everything.
Best of luck to you too, Alex. Take care.
Okay. Thank you. All right. Bye. Well, ladies and gentlemen, this is the final episode of Season 1 on the All Radio Show. While it has been a lot of work and commitment, it's also been a good learning experience. It's been great to talk with so many deep, visionary, outside-the-box, and revolutionary thinkers. I want to thank all my guests that were on the show, not only for taking the time to do it and being open, honest, and real on the show, but for what you all stand for and try to do in your day-to-day lives. It's people like you that really make a difference. I want to thank all the listeners and people who supported me. Anyone who's taken on a big undertaking knows that support and encouragement go a long way, and I thank you all. I want to send a special thanks to my main support, a beautiful human being that has more patience, resilience, and strength than anyone I've ever known. She's taught me more than she knows and has helped guide me through many ups and downs since we've known each other. She's been my best friend and confidant for the last 8 years. And to quote Chris Hedges, who I was turned on to by a guest of the show, friendship is about a relationship where that person loves you enough to tell you the unpleasant truth about yourself you don't want to hear because they care. Dawn Medeiros, I know you love and care for me. I love and care for you also. And through your patience, understanding, and love you've shown to me, you've made me a better person. Thank you. I hope everyone has a good summer, and I look forward to returning to the airwaves on Thursday, September 3rd. Season 2 promises to be harder hitting, with more diverse guests and differences of opinions. Until next time, keep your head up, stay strong, and question everything. And never forget, we are one.